The Christian Institute and the National Secular Society are not, on the face of it, natural bedfellows, but they've joined forces in the Defend Free Speech campaign, which is challenging the government's plans to introduce extremism disruption orders, or EDOs. Trevor Barnes explains why, and his report begins with the human rights campaigner Peter Tatchell.
Over the last two decades, I've many times taken on hate preachers, but I would defend their right to speak, even though I disagree with them, providing they don't involve harassment, threats, menaces, intimidation, or violence. Those, for me, are the red lines. Otherwise, the way to deal with hate preachers is to challenge their ideas, rebut what they say with evidence and rational argument.
But that very freedom to criticise, says Mr. Tatchell, is under threat from heavy-handed legislation. And in this he has the support, unusually, of the Christian Institute. In the past, it's defended the rights of Christians who it claims have been harassed by the overzealous use of legislation designed to protect people from hate crime. Street pastors, for example, arrested for sharing their approach to sexual ethics. The Institute's Deputy Director of Public Affairs is Simon Calvert.
We are increasingly living in a kind of culture in Britain where you can't say that is the order of the day. And it isn't just affecting Christians. It's affecting environmentalists who are getting themselves labelled as domestic extremists. It's affecting secularists who are being told that they can't say some of the things they want to say because the police say it will offend people. Yes, certainly Christians have found themselves on the wrong side of this kind of excessive culture of censoriousness, but they're not the only ones.
But the government has highlighted a particular problem, not simply Islamist terrorism, but illiberal views and practices, which, although non-violent in themselves, contribute to extremist thinking further down the line. Something Hannah Stewart of the political think tank the Henry Jackson Society by and large applauds.
I think the government's commitment to countering extremism, and particularly the commitment to countering non-violent extremism, should be welcomed. First of all, non-violent extremism causes significant social damage and divides communities and allows for the flourishment of hatred and the diminishment of individual rights. But also, it doesn't necessarily cause terrorism, but it is part of the milieu in which the ideology of terrorism can be justified and supported.
Where she disagrees strongly with the Home Secretary's thinking, however, is on the matter of the proposed extremist disruption orders, or EDOs, which would potentially make it an offence to say or do certain things which are currently legal, expressing an opinion, attending a lecture, or giving a speech of which somebody may disapprove.
Anything that seeks to restrict free speech without a legal definition or a credible and imminent threat, I don't think is justifiable, and that's what these measures are. I think they're both unnecessary and illiberal, and I don't think they'll work in principle or in practice.
I think that the EDOs are the greatest threat to freedom of expression that I have ever seen in this country, and we're starting from a pretty bad base.
Keith Porteous Wood, Executive Director of the National Secular Society.
The Public Order Act has religiously aggravated provisions that have a 7-year tariff and a very low prosecution threshold. They have a significant chilling effect on freedom of expression, and the prosecution threshold is so low that I think it's really anything that the Home Secretary doesn't like is the way it's going to end up.
Are you in any way, though, sympathetic to her attempt to curb excesses that you yourself would find offensive in Britain today?
I'm glad you used the word offensive. It's not about offence. We live in a pluralist society and we all ought to accept that we can be offended.
The Home Secretary's statement on counter-extremism made earlier this month was criticised by some Muslim groups, including the Muslim Council of Britain. Imam and broadcaster Ajmal Masroor says he can see why.
I think the current proposal, as the government has made, is very counterproductive. It hasn't come as a result of a consultation, wider consultation with the mainstream Muslim community organisations or individuals for that matter. And it has, of course, alienated. More people have become excluded and people feel their backs up against the wall.
Well, innocent people aren't. It's only those suspected of extremist behaviour, speech, activities.
No, because this proposal is curtailing on thoughts, on freedom of speech, freedom of assembly, freedom to a dissent within a particular narrative this government is creating. So, for example, if somebody criticizes government's foreign policy, according to some people, they will be termed as extremist or non-violent extremist.
But isn't there a case for saying, though, that, you know, something has to be done to challenge this kind of undercurrent of not in itself violent thinking, but activities and thoughts that do lead to violence?
I agree that we need to do something, but what is that one thing we need to do? And I think the most important thing we need to do is create a partnership.
For its part, the government says it has consulted Muslim opinion. Lord Ahmed, Minister for Countering Extremism, said this in a statement.
The measures in our counter-extremism strategy will not restrict anyone's freedom of speech or right to practice a faith. These are core values that help to make our country great. But we shouldn't allow extremists to go unchallenged, causing harm to our society and promoting hatred and division.
That imams and gay rights campaigners, Christian groups and secularists from left and right should be joining forces to oppose the prospect of EDOs is, according to Simon Calvert of the Christian Institute, a measure of the gravity of the issue.
These extremism disruption orders will be injected into that culture where some people think that standing up for the rights of the unborn or expressing the Christian sexual ethic or even simply explaining the exclusive claims of Christ, some people think that those views are objectionable, are offensive and ought to be silenced. And the danger is these new extremism disruption orders will be a gift to people like that.
But aren't you sympathetic to the Home Secretary's view that in these very specific times with a very particular threat, something like this needs to come into force in order to target, you know, in unusual times, these unusual offences?
No, I'm not persuaded. The government has not made the case. And, you know, if somebody is promoting extreme Islamist ideas, which are deeply unpleasant, but not actually leading to violence, then the best way of dealing with those ideas is to answer them, to rebut them, to argue against them, to prove why they're wrong, to ridicule them, to critique them, criticise them. That's the best way of dealing with poisonous ideas.
But Keith Porteous Wood of the National Secular Society goes further, saying the introduction of EDOs could ironically make it harder to criticise the very excesses the government wants to target.
I think making comments about Islam is becoming more and more difficult. One only needs to make the slightest critical comment for there to be calls of Islamophobia.
Yes, we all want to see people who are encouraging and soaking up terrorist violence and other violent acts brought to book. But, you know, there are plenty of laws already on the statute books to cover that.
But aren't you sympathetic to the Home Secretary's view that certain people who are not themselves committing extremist acts are contributing cumulatively, if you like, to an atmosphere that's stoking up the possibility of extremism in the future?
Well, you can't have a general law against stoking up a bit of an atmosphere. And the view seems to be, trust us, we'll only use it against the bad guys. Well, that's not how we do civil liberties in this country.
Simon Calvert ended that report by Trevor Barnes.